Hello. Hi, good evening. Bettina Korek and I and all our teams at the Serpentine are so delighted to welcome you all to tonight's Park Night with Linton Kwesi Johnson and Caleb Femi. Please give them a very, very big round of applause. Each year, our Serpentine Park Night series presents new performance commissions in the Serpentine's annual architectural commission, the Serpentine Pavilion. The Serpentine's 2022 Pavilion is, of course, the Black Chapel designed by Chicago-based artist Theaster Gates with the architectural support of RJ Associates. For Park Nights, this beautiful meditative pavilion, which Theaster described as a sacred space, transforms into the stage for a series of interdisciplinary engagements. Tonight is the second of our 22 Park Night series. It started in June with a performance by experimental jazz musician and composer Roscoe Mitchell. And actually, Roscoe, because Theaster considers this painting almost like a partition or a score for music, which can happen in this pavilion. So it was a session of improvisations. We then have in September and October a new play by artist Josiane Posey and a performance by the music collective Standing on a Corner. But tonight we are so, so delighted to have Linton Kwesi Johnson and Caleb Femi with us. Linton, of course, needs no introduction, a poet, a musician, an activist. Johnson's poems first appeared in the journal Race Today in 1974, and his first LP was released by Virgin Records in 1978. You also have actually pages from the 1974 release in the little booklet, which we hope you all have a copy. Born in Jamaica, Johnson moved to London in 63, attended Tulse Hill Secondary School, and later studied sociology at Goldsmiths College, University of London. While still in school, he was an active member in the Black Panther Party, helping to organize a poetry workshop within the movement. Johnson is a pioneering performance poet and has shaped the evolution of dub poetry. Over the last decades, he has released numerous books of poetry, including My Revolutionary Friend from 2002, one of only three books in Penguin's Modern Classics series by a living author, and the only in the series by a black author. He has recorded and released over 15 albums, including Drap Beaten Blood in 78, Forces of Victory in 79, Bass Culture in 1980, LKJ and Dub in 1980, and Making History in 1983. A new edition of Johnson's selected poems will be released by Penguin actually in a few weeks, in August 2022. It's featuring new poetry and also an afterword by Linton, as well as an introduction by Gary Young. We are so delighted to welcome Linton back here actually 15 years after the amazing dialogue here between Linton and Edouard Glissant, the late Martinique writer, poet, and philosopher. And when we invited actually Edouard to London, he said he would only come if he could perform here with his friend Linton Kwesi Johnson, who has inspired him so, so much. And we are incredibly delighted that this idea of inviting to invite continues tonight, because Linton made a wonderful suggestion to invite Caleb Femi to actually, after him, read poems here tonight, and Linton will then introduce Caleb. Caleb's extraordinary book, Poor, was described by Terence Hayes actually as the fabulous debut where concrete becomes a paradox of toughness and vulnerability, confinement and shelter. It's simply stunning. Every image is a revelation. Please give a very, very, very warm welcome to Linton Kwesi Johnson.
Thank you very much. Good evening. Thank you, Hans, for your generous introduction and for inviting me here. I accepted the invitation because I felt it would be a perfect opportunity to celebrate the new edition of my selected poems, which have been in print for 20 years. Can you imagine a poetry book in print for 20 years? That's what it looks like. What I'm going to do in this session is to recite a few poems from each section of the book. It's basically divided into three sections, 70s verse, 80s verse, 90s verse. And it was first published as a modern classic by Penguin. And you know, I'm under no illusions that the only reason why I was published under that list is because there was a black editor at Penguin named Ella Alfrey. Otherwise, this book would never have been published by them. So, you know, what I'm trying to say, it's important to have people of color in these institutions, you know, like Penguin and all the other big publishing houses. So my journey with poetry began in the early 70s, and it began with this poem called Five Nights of Bleeding, which describes a number of violent incidents which occurred in various parts of London involving the youth of my generation. And of course, violence is really an aspect of youth culture everywhere. It wasn't something particular to the black youth of my generation. Five Nights of Bleeding for Leroy Harris. Madness, madness. Madness tight on the heads of the rebels, the bitterness erupts like a hot blast. Broke glass. Rituals of blood on the burning, served by a cruel infighting. Five nights of horror and of bleeding. Broke glass. Cold blades as sharp as the eyes of hate and the stabbings. It's war amongst the rebels. Madness, madness, war. Night number one was in Brixton. Soprano B sound system was a beating out a rhythm with fire coming down his reggae, reggae wire. It was a sound shaking down your spinal column, a bad music tearing up your flesh. And the rebels them start a fighting, the youth them just turn wild. It's war amongst the rebels, madness, madness, war. Night number two down at Shepherd's, right up Railton Road. It was a night named Friday when everyone was high on brew or Jew, a pound or two worth of Cali. Sound coming down Neville King's music iron. The rhythm just bubbling and backfiring, raging and rising, when suddenly the music cut. Steel blade drinking blood in darkness. It's war amongst the rebels. Madness, madness, war. Night number three, over the river, right outside the rainbow. Inside, James Brown was screaming soul. Outside, the rebels were freezing cold. Babylonian tyrants descended, pounced on the brothers who were bold. So with a flick of the wrist, a jab and a stab, the song of blades was sounded. The bile of oppression was vomited, and two policemen wounded. Righteous, righteous war. Night number four at a blues dance. Two rooms packed and the pressure pushing up, hot, hot heads. Rituals of blood in a blues dance. Broke glass, splintering fire, axes, blades, brain blast. Rebellion rushing down the wrong road, storm blowing down the wrong tree. And Leroy bleeds near death on the fourth night in a blues dance on a black rebellious night. It's war amongst the rebels, madness, madness, war. Night number five at the Telegraph. Vengeance walked through the doors, so slow, so smooth, so tight and ripe and smash. Broke glass. A bottle finds a head and the shell of the fire hurt cracks. The victim feels fear, finds hands, holds knife, finds throat. Oh, the stabbings and the bleeding and the blood. It's war amongst the rebels. Madness, madness, war. Now, it was clear to the black youth of my generation, once we became teenagers, that the Metropolitan Police Force had declared war against us. And in a sense, it has been a protracted war, which has been waged over decades, and it continues to be waged against black youth. One of the weapons they had at their disposal was an old piece of Victorian legislation called the Vagrancy Act, which was used during the time of Queen Victoria to control the movements of the unemployed. It had been largely forgotten about until the youth of my generation turned up on the scene, whereupon it was suddenly rediscovered and used against us. Invariably, you would be arrested and charged with attempting to steal from persons unknown. And it was your word against the police officer. And in that way, a significant section of my generation were criminalized by racist police officers. There was a campaign to get rid of this law, and some mothers, some black women based in Lewisham were at the head of the campaign, and I contributed a poem to the campaign in the form of a letter called Sonny's Letter. Brixton Prison, Jeb Avenue, London, Southwest to England. Dear Mama, good day. I hope that when these few lines reach you, they may find you in the best of health. Mama, I really don't know how to tell you this, cause I did make a solemn promise to take care of little Jim and try my best to look out for him. Mama, I really did try my best, but nonetheless, me sorry to tell you, sir, poor little Jim get a rest. It was the middle of the rush hour when everybody just a hustle and a bustle to go home for them evening shower. Me and Jim stand up waiting upon a bus, not causing no fuss, when all on a sudden a police van pull up. Out jump three policemen, the whole of them carrying baton. Them walk straight up to me and Jim. One of them hold on to Jim, say him taking him in. Jim tell him to let go of him, for him not do nothing, and him not a thief, not even a button. But Jim start to wriggle, the police start to giggle. Mama, make I tell you what them do to Jim. Mama, make I tell you what them do to him. Them thump him in him belly and it turn to jelly. Them lick him pon him back and him rib get pop. Them lick him pon him head but it tough like lead. Them kick him in him seed and it started to bleed. Mama, I just couldn't stand up there and I do nothing. So me joke one in him eye and him started to cry. Me thump one in him mouth and him started to shout. Me kick one pan him shin and him started to spin. Me thump him pan him chin and him drop pan a bin and crash. And dead. Mama, more policemen come down and beat me to the ground. Them charge Jim for sus. Them charge me for murder. Mama, don't fret. Don't get depressed and downhearted. Be of good courage till I hear from you. I remain your son, Sonny. The year 1981 is the most significant in the history of the black experience in this country. On the 17th of January that year, Yvonne Ruddock was celebrating her 16th birthday at 439 New Cross Road in Southeast London when some fascists threw an incendiary device through the window of the house, which resulted in a fire in which 13 young black people died, 14 committed suicide, 26 were seriously injured. And within less than 48 hours, without having carried out any forensic investigation, the police declared completely out of hand that it was not an arson attack, they said. But it was the police themselves who told it wasn't a racist arson attack, but it was the police themselves who informed Mrs. Ruddock that it was an arson attack. And those kind of arson attacks were not rare. They'd been happening with monotonous regularity. A member of parliament named Jill Knight from Birmingham stirred up a lot of hostility against West Indian parties, complaining about the noise. A similar arson attack happened in Forest Hill in 1971. Luckily, no one died there. And someone was, in fact, arrested and charged and convicted for that act. In the case of the New Cross fire, the New Cross massacre, the police wasted taxpayers' money covering up the real causes of the fire and launched a campaign of lies and disinformation. In March of that year, in spite of the police's propaganda campaign, in spite of the hostility from the gutter press and other sections of the media, the New Cross Massacre Action Committee were able to mobilize 20,000 people, and we marched from New Cross to Hyde Park here to protest the death of those young people and the way the matter had been handled by the authorities. In April of that year, they had an inquest. April, only 3 months after the fire. The inquest was conducted with indecent haste. And it was presided over by a very nasty little man called Dr. Davis. Anyway, the verdict was an open one. In April of 1981, the police launched an operation called Operation Swamp 81, where they went about harassing and intimidating people, black people, going about their everyday lawful business. And we had an insurrection, an uprising, a riot. And those riots spread to every major inner city area in England. The Black People's Day of Action and those uprisings of 1981 was the first watershed moment in our history and marks the period when things began to change. So here's a poem about the Brixton riots called The Great Insurrection. It was in April 1981, down in the ghetto of Brixton, that the Babylon them caused such a friction that it bring about a great insurrection. And it spread all over the nation. It was truly an historical occasion. It was event of the year, and I wish I had been there when we run riot all over Brixton, when we mash up plenty police van. when we mash up the wicked one's plan, when we mash up the swampy 81, for what? For make the ruler them understand that we not take no more of them oppression. And when me check out the ghetto grapevine, fi find out all I could have find, every rebel just a revel in them story. Them a talk about the power and the glory. Them a talk about the burning and the looting. Them a talk about the smashing and the grabbing. Them a tell me about the vanquish and the victory. Them said the Babylon them went too far. So what? We had was fi bun to care. And one and two innocent get mar. But what? Not so it go sometime in a war in star. Not so it go sometime in a war. Them say we bun down the judge. We could have bun the landlord. We bun down the judge. We never bun the landlord. When we run riot all over Brixton. When we mash up plenty police van. When we mash up the wicked one plan. When we mash up the swampy 81. Them say we commandeer care and we gather ammunition. We build we barricade and the wicked catch afraid. We send out, we scout, figure find them we're about. Then we farm up, we posse and we make raid. We know them run gang up plan counter action. But the plastic bullet and the water cannon will bring a blam blam, will bring a blam blam. Never mind scar man, will bring a blam blam. Scarman being, of course, Lord Scarman, who conducted an inquiry into the reasons, causes of the uprisings, made some recommendations for reform and so on, and about policing, which was by and large ignored by the police. And many of us felt that that inquiry was a bit of a whitewash. A year later, 1982, has special significance for me personally because I lost my father that year. My father never traveled to England, stayed in Jamaica, where he tried to raise another family, having separated from my mother, and lived in West Kingston, and died at the age of 56, having had both his legs amputated because of diabetes. So I wrote this poem around that time for my father. But it's also a poem, it's not just an elegy for my father, it's also a poem about Jamaica in the early 1980s. Reggae fi dada. Galang dada, galang gwan yasa. You never had no life to live, just the one life to give. You did your time upon earth, you never get your just desert. Galang go smile in the sun, galang go sata in the palace of peace. Oh, the water, it's so deep, the water, it's so dark, and it's full of harbor shark. The land is like a rock, slowly shattering to sand, sinking in a sea of calamity, where fear breeds shadows that lurks in the dark, where people afraid to walk, afraid to think, afraid to talk, where the present is haunted by the past. A desa me born, get to know about storm, learn to cling to the dawn. And when me hear my daddy sick, me quickly pack my grip and take a trip. Me never have no time when me reach, fi see no sunny beach when me reach. Just people are living shock, people living back to back amongst cockroach and rat, amongst dirt and disease, subject to terrorist attack, political intrigue, constant grief and a sign of relief. Oh, the grass turned brown, so many trees cut down and the land is overgrown. From country to town is just thistle and thorn in the wound of the poor. Is a miracle how them endure the pain night and day, the stench of decay, the glaring sights of guarded affluence, the arrogant vices, cool eyes of contempt, the mocking symbols of independence. At this I'm born, get to know about storm, learn to cling to the dawn. And when the news reached me, send me one daddy dead, me catch a plane quick. And when me reach me sunny isle, it was the same old style. The money well dry, the bullets them a fly, plenty innocent a die, many rivers run dry, ganja planes flying high. The poor man him a try, you think a little try him try, holding on by and by, when a dollar can buy a little dinner for a fly. Galang dada, galang guan yasa. You never had no life to live, just the one life to give. You did your time upon earth, you never get your just desert. Galango smile in the sun, Galango sata in the palace of peace. Me know you couldn't take it, Dada. The anguish and the pain, the suffering, the problems, the strain. Struggling in vain to make two ends meet so that them picnic could a get a little something to eat. To put clothes upon them back, to put shoes upon them feet, when a dollar can buy a little dinner for a fly. Me know you try, Dada. You fight a good fight, but the dice them did loaded and the card pack fix. Yet still, you reach 56 before you lose your leg wicket. I know you're born wrong here, so we bury you down a stranger's burying ground, near to Mum and Cousin Doris, not far from the quarry, down at August Town. That's all right. Is my 20 minutes up yet? Huh? No? All right, well, you know, I once did a seminar at Georgetown University with the great Derek Walcott. And Derek Walcott made a statement in which he said that the elegy is the destiny of poetry. Well, I don't know about that, but as I got a bit older, I found myself writing more of them. This is an elegy I wrote for a sister poet from Germany, Mai Opitz, also known as Mai Ayim. And she died tragically in 1996. She was born in Hamburg, but settled in Berlin, where she became involved in the Afro-German movement and the women's movement based in Berlin. She had multiple sclerosis, she didn't know that. But once she was told that she had that, she went to a high-rise building and jumped from the 13th floor and died. Reggae fi Mai Ayim. It weird how life with death can conspire. Fi shatter the art's most fragile desire. How history and biography can plot against you, and them angst and them anomy gang upon you. Afro-German warrior woman from Hamburg via Bremen, then finally Berlin. It was in the dazzling atmosphere at the Black Radical Book Fair that me sight you, sweet sister, bright-eyed like hope, like a young antelope who could have cope with the daily, the flowering of the spirit, with the everyday erosion of the soul. Two passing clouds, you and I, in the desert of the sky, exchanging vapor. But in the commerce of the art, was it fair trade in regret, in love and laughter? Me never know, me couldn't tell, me should have said, say, through all the learning, the teaching, resisting and assisting, the loving, the giving, organizing and defying, that the Kaiser of darkness did capture your heart. That the last time me see you would be the last time me see you. That you was free, falling, 13 stanzas down, your final poem in blood upon the ground. That so sudden, that so soon, you would have fly out upon a one-way ticket to Ghana, go and catch up with your past amongst your ancestors. We give thanks for the life you share with we. We give thanks for the light you shine upon we. We give thanks for the love you show upon we. We give thanks for your memory. Am I 20 minutes up yet? Yeah? Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. It was Shamila Beesmahun, my wife, who made me aware of Kalib Femi's poetry. I found Poor, his astonishingly accomplished first collection, a treasure trove of insight, irony, storytelling, and imagination. It was quite simply a riveting read. Kalib is careful of craft, but not afraid to experiment with form. In my humble opinion, he is well on the way to finding his voice. Ladies and gentlemen, a warm welcome for writer, filmmaker, and poet, Kalib Femi.
Hello, hi, how you guys doing? Don't really like to talk too much, I'm reading poetry, so hopefully this should suffice. Honey Trap and Little Boy. What do you know about mercy? The little boy from the ends know it be the last thing you plead when dust settles. What do you know about this story, the full of it? When the single cloud was moving at the pace of wisdom, they called Tasha a setup chick. But the truth was that the little boy was an arrogant fool. We would need a new set of images to map out what happened. Off ends, caught slipping, six ops. But first, tell me what you know about Reebok Classics, Dipset, Sovereign Rings, Aquamasters, Flexing. This has nothing to do with nostalgia, but to access the story, you would need to take yourself back to the last time that you heard a scream that didn't signal rain. Out of the belly of the little boy, blue with running, with shiny rubber limbs playing little boy games, the hands of his laughing scream, feeling the walls, the way bats converse with the dark world. You know them way there. When the afternoon carried one atomic intent, horny little boy playing horny little games, baking in laughter like he'd be the first to be horny in history, forgetting how he came to be born. You know them way there. Dashing around the estate, trying not to get seen by those aunties that loved to snitch. Anyway, the story started with a text. Tasha's your cuz, she's Leng, give me her number. And maybe she was Leng, or maybe her skin was just light like it was plated in gold. Little boy, trying to get up in them panties, ain't got a clue what to do if he got up in them panties. This one's in the booklet. It's kind of a cheat to read it since it's already there, but you can read along. You'll be 4 minutes from home when you are cornered by an officer who will tell you of a robbery 40 minutes ago in the area. You fit the description of a man. You'll laugh. 13. You'll tell him you're 13. You'll be patted on the shoulder then by another fed whose face takes you back to Gloucester Primary School, a Wednesday assembly about being little stars. This officer had a horizon in the east of his smile when he told your class that you were all supernovas, the biggest and brightest stars. You will show the warmth of your teeth, praying he remembers your supernova. He will see you powerless, plump. You will watch the two men cast lots for your organs. Do you remember me, you ask? You gave a talk at my primary school. While fear condenses on your lips, you'll remember the Wednesday after the assembly, your teacher speaking more about supernovas, how they are in fact dying stars on the verge of becoming black holes. I forgot the page what the next one's in, hold on. 30, all right, this one, I wasn't really sure I was gonna read, and then Linton was like, this is the page. When Linton says to read a certain poem, you get me? All right, this is called Schrodinger's Black. Speaking of riots, one of the saddest things is the reoccurrence of history. I met a few weeks ago a young boy who was like born on the day of the London riots, the most recent London riots. And I was working for London Zoo at the time. What are you looting for? Asked the evening news, and the crowd continued looting. I wasn't there, but I thought I was. My brazen face on the nation's screen, half tucked under a t-shirt, chucking bricks. An expert on riots was invited to speak about why these particular young people were rioting. While he talked, they showed more footage. A bus set on fire, hooded boys with overgrown nails, a sky that refused to bring shine or rain like it decided to mind its own business, a police helmet with a broken visor, horses clumsy chopping through piles of debris. All the chaos and poise of a campfire story. They showed Mark Duggan, and it was a picture of me even though I wasn't dead. That's what it's like to be black here, like you're dead and alive at the same time. And though those experts spoke on the mayhem, nothing was said about the maddening of grief. Nothing was said about loss and how people take and take to fill the void of who's no longer there. A correspondent in the riot zone asked an old man about the situation, and he said this time they demanded payment for death. So they shook the city for change. Unsatisfied, she asked the woman but couldn't make out the words through her accent. Demand dead. Demanded what? Demand dead. 21. I think 21 is like, dark skin boys scare everything in the dark, though really, we're just trying to scare away the dark. Round here, this is how we greet each other. What's good, my G? As if to say, are you safe, my G? Isn't this how you would call out to your friends if you too was in a dark place, standing on the edge of a ledge? Shout out to us boys who play out here. God knows how we do it. Or maybe God doesn't know. Maybe an estate tall as it is the half-buried bone of an old god, the blue light of dawn, his son watching on at the things we do when there is one less boy amongst us. How we pour the Holy Spirit out the bottle onto the concrete where his ashes lie, stir it into a clay, mold it into a new body, and like a kite in fading wind, watch his soul sink back down to good earth to settle in his body like it never left. Isn't this what you would do for your friends if you too was in a dark place, standing on the edge of a ledge? All right, I'm gonna read this last one. I don't know what it is, it just says page 50. Oh, by the way, this is shameless plug. They make you do that nowadays, isn't it? You've seen it, it's called Poor. And there's, it's always funny because there's always like crisp notes that go into donation boxes. Mad. It's absolutely good, good, but you man got money. Okay, so I think I really wanted to, one of the heaviest things about this collection for me and the next collection that I'm writing, just no sadness, no heaviness, no trauma, just a bunch of good times. And it's always apt to end on something like this. Here too, spring comes to us with open arms and it looks like this. A few youngers sprawled out like a deck of trick cards on the back stairs, talking all that talk about any day now they'll be taken under the wing of a dragon. Little cousins unseen in a side pocket of the function, plotting a sleepover. If you ask my mum and I ask yours, they'll say yes. Twilight and three unbroken voices at the back of the bus. Flat earth theories, flat asses, flat shoes. Sweet nonsense chatting. The wickedest wine from Chantel and a boy would have fell on the dance floor if the arms of his brethren didn't hold him up like scaffolding. Two men bouncing along the pavement. Through another eye, they look like young dolphins splicing coastal waves. Two schoolgirls walking down the street laughing. Nobody knows why. A room of unraveling ribbons reaching for the same microphone to spit over an Eskimo instrumental. A boy smiles at the mirror, welcoming a new strip of muscle breaking through the sheen of boyishness. A fresh pair of Air Jordans clean like a smile, and everywhere they touch is hallowed ground. A boy who takes pain like a stone, looks up and imagines stars hanging in the night sky like meditating monks. A girl sends a risky text. The universe gasps. Sound falls in on itself. A riskier text is replied. At dusk, the boy walks through the park. No police, no ops, only the company of spirits. Thank you for listening to me, guys.
Linton suggested that we do a brief Q&A, and that will be then a transition to a few more poems by Linton. But before that, a big, big round of applause for Linton and Caleb. Thank you so much. Now, Linton, before, when we spoke, you said one thing you'd really like to talk tonight about is reggae, and I wanted to kind of ask you, because you're known as a poet, but also as a recording artist, and I wanted to ask you about the connection, how the two things connect.
I am known all over the world as a reggae artist, and few people know that most of my reggae recordings began life as poems. That were published, some of them were published in magazines and some of them in books before I recorded them. And I never called myself a dub poet. I called myself, in the early days, I called myself a reggae poet because I understood that there was something called jazz poetry, for example, and there was something called blues poetry. I'm thinking of the poetry of Langston Hughes and people like that, Gwendolyn Brooks, and the last poets, And I said, I wanted, when I was trying to find my voice as a young poet, I said, I wanted to do something like that, but from my own Jamaican cultural heritage, you know, from a reggae tradition. And reggae lyricism, the lyricism of reggae music has always was an important part of my poetics. And the reason why people know me as a poet is largely because of my reggae recordings. And how that happened was that I felt that one could reach a wider audience with poetry if it had some nice music behind it, you know? And since the actual structure of the poems I was writing, the language of the poetry I was writing at the time lent itself to reggae music, I thought that was a logical thing to do. Next thing I knew, my first album became a success, and then I had a 40-odd year career as a reggae artist. So there you go.
And we are celebrating tonight the book of your poem, of the selected poems. A book was first published, thank you, in 2002, and will now be reissued, including also new poems. You once told me, when we met a few months ago, that it took you 20 years to find your voice, and that in the 70s there was an urgency of expression, in the 80s there was a learning of the craft. Could you tell us a little bit about this finding of the...
Well, you know, when you start, I don't know about other poets, but for me, when I began, it was a need, an urge to express how I felt. How I felt about the experiences of growing up in England in a racially hostile environment. And I was inspired by a book called The Souls of Black Folk by W.E.B. Du Bois, the African-American scholar. And then through my mentors, John LaRose and Andrew Salke, I discovered, you know, a lot of poetry books written by people from the Caribbean and Africa and America. So after my initial attempts at writing verse, I didn't know anything about poetry, it didn't appeal to me at school, I realized that there was more to it than just getting something off your chest. So, you know, the next stage, the next phase was basically learning my craft. And through learning my craft, eventually, I found my voice.
And when we did the talk here in 2007 with Edouard Glissant, who brought us together, the theme of the evening was really remembering Michael Smith.
Oh, yes.
And you talked about Michael Smith as being one of the most original voices of the 20th century, as a really quintessential performance poet, as an electrifying performer who works about whose work is about the dehumanization of the poor. Can you talk about the importance of Michael Smith and why we have to remember Michael
well,
Smith?
Well, Michael Smith was an extraordinarily gifted poet who had a great command of Jamaican language. From the oral tradition to the written one. And as a student at the Jamaica School of Drama, he brought a theoretical dimension to the performance of his poems. You see, that's how this dub poetry thing came about. I coined the term dub poetry many years ago in talking about the reggae DJs of the pioneering reggae DJs like U-Roy, Prince Jazzbo, Big Youth, and so on. But Mikey Smith, and Oko Onura, and Gene Binterbreeze, the late Gene Binterbreeze, and some other students at the School of Drama were part of a movement that called themselves dub poets. And it was a movement of orality. John LaRue has called it a revival of orality in Caribbean poetry. And Michael was, I think, the most talented out of that early generation. And of course, he came here to perform at the International Book Fair of Radical Black and Third World Books in 1982 and recited a poem called Me Can't Believe It, and just took the literary scene by storm, you know, and tragically died in 83, stoned to death in Stony Hill by some political thugs. But he was a great poet, and we never really saw his full potential because, you know, he left us so early.
And when you talked here about him, you also talked about poetry and activism, and you told us that your poetry grew out of activism, of your work with the Black Panther. And I wanted to ask you to tell us a bit about that, about how poetry grew out of activism. Well, and when we met a few months ago, you said that you're hopeful because you see, after 20 years of less hope, you see now again hope of new activism.
Well, yeah, I think it's dangerous, very dangerous, to be prescriptive for poetry. You can't tell people what to write and how to write it. That is to put a limitation on the poetic imagination. But I came to poetry through politics as a young activist, and I was always drawn to political poetry, and as well as to lyrical poetry. I love poems that sang or sings. And a lot of my early verse, I suppose you could call agitprop poems, because they came out of campaigns that I was involved in, like Sonny's Letter, for example, which was part of the campaign to get rid of the infamous SUS laws. I wrote a poem called It Dreadinna England, and that came out of a campaign that I was involved in to establish the innocence of and win the freedom of a man called George Lindo, who had been framed with robbing a post office by some cops up in Leeds, and so on. So I'm often inspired by the political issues of the time to write a poem, but not exclusively so.
And actually, you were inspired again to write new poems, because in the book there are actually three or four new poems, and you said it's actually your mother who made you write.
Well, yes, poetry. I mean, I never thought I'd write another poem for about 20 years or so. And then my mother became my muse, and she inspired me. I went to visit her in Jamaica and saw her a couple of years before she died. I realized that she was on the way out, and I wrote something. And then during the lockdown, I wrote something else. And But I don't think I'm not very hopeful that this is a new period of creativity.
But there is also a poem you wrote for Steve McQueen in the book.
Oh, well, Steve McQueen, I don't know if people saw his amazing series, Uprising. Is it called Uprising? Yeah, which covered a lot of things, including some of the things I write about in my own verse, including the New Cross Fire. And he called me and he said, "Linton, I need a way to end this film." And he told me, he said, "You know, Sir Collins, the sound system operator and record producer, whose son had died in the fire, had planted 13 oak trees And then he went back and planted a 14th one after the young guy committed suicide, as a kind of memorial to those young people who died in the fire. So he said, "I don't want nothing long, just a few lines, you know." So I just thought about that and wrote those few lines for him.
I'm so excited that now we will hear a few more poems by you. I wanted to say also a few thank yous. I wanted to thank Claude Argil, curator at large, and Kate Wong, assistant curator of the Serpentine, the amazing Serpentine Dream Team. Thank goes to Velosa, to Boiler Room, to Nicholas Chapman, Charlotte Morgan, Harriet Clark at Penguin Random House, your publisher, and our Park Night supporters, Bloomberg Philanthropies, and Arts Council England. And now another very warm welcome for Linton for the next poetry reading.
Thank you. I'm going to do three poems. If you get fed up, you know, just tell me to shut up and come and sit down. Now, some years ago, I found in the Oxford Companion to 20th Century Poetry an entry on so-called dub poetry, and there was a rather disparaging remark quoted about dub poetry made by another Jamaican poet of a different generation who said, quote, "Dub poetry is overcompensation for deprivation," unquote. And I thought to myself, well, people associate my name with dub poetry, even though I don't call myself a dub poet. So I can't just let that go by just like that. So by way of riposte, I wrote this piece. And there's a reference here to Buthelezi. People will remember the Zulu chief who was the thorn in the flesh of Nelson Mandela's ANC and a collaborator with the apartheid regime. And Lance Percival, a very popular English comic actor who also did awful parodies of calypsos. So, do I need to explain anything else? No, that's it. So here is the poem called "If I Was a Top-Notch Poet." If I was a top-notch poet, like Chris Okigbo, Derek Walcott, or T.S. Eliot, I would write a poem so damn deep that it bittersweet, like a precious memory will make you weep, will make you feel incomplete. Like when you love a leaf, and do a defeat you concede, still you beg and you plead, till you win a reprieve and you're ready for rock steady, but the music done already. Still, in the meantime, with me rhythm, with me rhyme, with me rough bass line, with me own sense of time, goon poet of a step in line. Kabuta lazy might have got couple thousand, but Mandela fame, thousands of thousands of thousands of thousands. If I was a top-notch poet, like Kamau Brathwaite, Martin Carter, Jean Cortez or Amiri Baraka, I would write a poem so rude and rootsy and subversive that it make the goon poet turn white with envy. Like a candomblé, voodoo, kumina chant, a whole time calypso or a folk song that get banned. But from granny right down to Grand Pickney, each and every one can recite that they want. Still, in the meantime, with me rhythm, with me rhyme, with me rough bass line, with me one sense of time, goon poet of a step in line. Kabuta lazy might have got couple thousand, but Mandela fame thousands of thousands of thousands of thousands. If I was a top-notch poet, like Jikaya Yotamsi, Nicholas Gwen, or Lana Goodison, I would write a poem so beautiful that it's simple. Like a plain girl with good brains and nice ways, with a sexy disposition and plenty compassion, with a sweet smile and a subtle style. Still, me nah go bow and scrape and go on like a ape, peddling no puerile parchment of ethnicity, with ungla vague fleeting hint of authenticity, like a black Lance Percival in reverse, or even worse, a babbling buffoon will lose him tongue. No, sir, not at all. Me got me rhythm, me got me rhyme, me got me rough bass line, me got me one sense of time. Goon poet of a step in line. Kabuta lazy might have got couple thousand, but Mandela fame thousands of thousands of thousands of thousands. Here's a couple of new poems. During the COVID, you going, June? You going? All right. Yeah, during the COVID lockdown, I was inspired to write this poem because I experienced something which I hadn't experienced in a very, very long time, simply by taking a walk in the park. And this poem is new, you know, so I'm not used to it. You know, you have to get used to a poem when you write a poem. It's like you buy a new pair of shoes. You know, you have to wear it in before it feels comfortable. So here we go anyway. It's called The First Lockdown. It's just after the first lockdown start ease down and social bubble gets so big, them a burst. Treading up and down round my local park, enjoying my daily medicinal walk, taking in the scenes and the sounds. Me a try my best to steer far from the heavy breathing jogger who find 2 meter too far. Since everybody under house arrest, the park transformed from popular to treasured oasis of togetherness. People scatter like litter all over the clean-cut carpets of green, redeeming earth and sky and sunlight. Some sit in a wide, wide circle, like in some ancient tradition, a ritual of reverence to life. On picnicking slopes, al fresco diners a savor the taste of togetherness. Gazebos pop up like mushrooms, festooned with buntings and balloons. Sunbather strip down to bare essential, soaking up the vitamin D. Rounders, football, volleyball, all kind of ball game a play. My boy would playground shut down, but like ball fetching, tail wagging puppies, watch them screaming, cavorting children, really getting high on play. A family of cycles own the walkway. Entitled strollers walking 6 abreast. Knitted brows soon give way to broad elastic smiles. Tiny droplets of distress vanish in the warm spring air. Only the loud parakeet them a quarrel high up in the furnace of them tree. Under baby blue sky, proud young mamas wheeling them precious cargoes of love. A vigilant foraging magpie, stylishly pluming black and white, gets suspicious and takes sudden flight. stepping down the hill to the pond, stepping with a rhythm in my head, mindful of skateboard and e-scooter that in the blink of an eye scoot by. Plenty pigeon parade by the pond side, down from them perch for a feast, peck, peck, pecking with cool disdain. The resident swan and cygnets find a quiet corner in the water, away from prying eyes and sounds of wonder. Birthday party a gwan further on, a cool reggae beat in the heat. This is a day like no other I remember, a magical day of exuberant light, Bob's natural mystic floating in the air. Above the joyful sounds of music and laughter, me still hear it loud and clear everywhere, the unrelenting wailing sound of sirens. I think I'm gonna sit the last one out. Yes, that's better. Yeah, my mother died in October 2020, 13th of October. And I saw her January of that year, and I think I must have realized that I wouldn't see her alive again. But from a visit in 2017, I'd written a poem for her because, you know, I knew she was going. My mother was born in a place called Sandy River in the parish of Clarendon in Jamaica. She came here in 1961 or 62, and then she retired to Jamaica back in 1988. And she was quite happy there. I said to her, wouldn't you like to come back to England? She says, if they were giving away England for nothing, I don't want none of it. Anyway, yeah. So she enjoyed sitting on her veranda, watching the world go by. And that's how I remember, that's what inspired this poem. I'm one of these people who have to take off their glasses to read. So this poem, it's an elegy for my mother. It's called Reggae for Mama or Good Night. And Shame O' Lady is a little shrub that grows in Jamaica. If you touch it, the leaves kind of fold in on themselves, and after a few minutes they come back out again, and we call it Shame Old Lady. Sit down pan veranda in your wheelchair, Shame Old Lady now growing at your gate. Your daughter them beard and powder you, put you in a nappy like baby. Children are run up and down out a road, them laughter is music in your ears. You is a big girl now in Sandy River, bathing under rose apple tree. Sit down pan veranda in your wheelchair, in the calming evening atmosphere. No heaviness of heart, no worrying thought, just a peaceful feeling deep within. Flowers in your garden please your eye, a ripe Julie mango drop a grung. Bird pan light post a sing a late song, you a wonder what tomorrow a go bring. Sit down pan veranda in your wheelchair, thankful for the little cool breeze. Arthritis make your bone them betray you, No bitter tears linger upon your tongue. Battalions of clouds marching yonder. The weary sun soon gone to bed. Light a fade fast in the twilight. Time a draw near, if you say. Good night. Thank you.